Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our Saturday FB Live. And today being the last Saturday of 2020, we have got your question more like a poser. Are you looking forward to or fearing 2021? To give us an insight into this, we have Dr. Ali with us, who will be taking you through this session. Welcome, Dr. Ali.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Meera. Yes, this thought has been, hitting me. How many of us are, looking forward to 2021? How many of us are fearing what will happen and what horrible things will continue in 2021? Lots of these thoughts have been going on. Innumerable people that I've been talking to have been giving very diverse opinions about it and things like that. So I thought, let us end the year by having an open discussion. I'm not taking sides either way. I respect everybody's opinion. But then a few, maybe, that chicken soup for the soul, as they say. Let's have a few thoughts today. And you can mull over that. We've still got 3-4 days left before the year ends. And then you can plan out what you're going to do with the brand new year, which is going to come in next week. Let me start off with reminding you of that old children's story, which you may have forgotten. I think it was Hans Christian Andersen who wrote that very popular story about the emperor's new coat. The story, if you recollect, goes like this, that there was this trickster who came to a very egoistic emperor and said that, I can make a fantastic coat of gold, which will be the best coat that any human being has ever worn and things like that. So he pampered this emperor's ego. And he told, emperor was very happy, and he said, yes, go ahead and make it. And he started, the emperor gave instructions to his treasurers to give him as much gold as he wants. And he took a spinning wheel and he just kept spinning the wheel without making any thread out of the gold. And people were surprised. Then he told the emperor, my lord, only the good human beings, the wise people, will be able to see the coat. The fools and idiots will not be able to see the coat. Now people are seeing this man is making a coat and I don't see it. So does it mean I am stupid, I am an idiot, I am good for nothing, I am a dunce? So nobody wanted to admit that. Every one of them said, how beautifully the coat is coming out. What texture, what cloth, what a lovely design. And finally, the day came, he told the emperor that I made the coat. And he came holding something, nothing in his hand, and told the emperor, sir, please turn around, I'll put the coat on you. And he did as though he is putting the coat on. And the emperor could not see the coat. Now imagine the emperor, if he says, I can't see the coat, that means what? That means he's also a fool. No. Emperor looked at the coat and said, wonderful, I'm so happy. And the emperor sat on top of an elephant and a procession came out, emperor wearing his new golden coat. And everybody in the city was there. And they all looked and each one of them said, I can't see the coat. But nobody wanted to admit it. And every one of them started, cheering, wow, what a great coat. Oh, emperor looking so good in this golden coat and so unique and things like that. Till the emperor was going past a small child. The child in all his innocence looked at the emperor and said, but the emperor is not wearing a coat. And then it dawned on everybody from the emperor downwards how they have been made fools of. It took a child to bring out the reality. Now you will think, why am I telling you this childhood story? Because to me, this COVID thing that came is an emperor's coat. I think it has created such a fear, such so much anxiety, which was unheard of for years and decades. But then you've forgotten that there are people like me who have been around for decades and decades. And along with that, people like me have also very ardently studied history from the human angle. So I know what has been happening to the world much, much, much before this COVID business came. Exactly 100 years back, we had a plague. It was there again all over the world, all over the country, etc. But take a city like Bangalore. They say that 1/3 of Bangalore was wiped out. That many deaths took place. Every third individual in Bangalore, child or adult, died with the plague. And then what happened? The city not only continued, but so many new localities came up where people realized that these congested localities where the rats were, they were the ones which had propagated the plague. So they made new layouts. They made nice wide roads. They made big houses. They made sure that, you know, there are no rats and there is no plague and things of that sort. And life started afresh. In fact, many of the traditional wonderful localities that we are proud of in Bangalore, which have got these tree-lined avenues and wide roads and bungalows and all that, are directly or indirectly a result of the plague. This is what happens. I mean, I can go on and on reeling. There was that great fire that took place in London, where they say again 1/4 or 1/3 of London structures all burned down. They were all so close to each other. Most of them had so much wood and this and that, that one after another, tens of thousands of houses in London burned down. But that gave rise to a new London, a modern London. Wonderful, new, strong structures, beautiful structures, good quality of living, and London awoke. But what happens is, in between, we have these doomsday prophets. We have these people who somehow get some vicarious pleasure about telling everybody the worst that could or could not even happen. There was a very interesting story my father had told me long back, that somewhere in the late 1800s, when London was a booming city, and before the automobile, obviously, people used to use horses or animals to move around. And London was growing, and more and more and more of horses and mules and ponies were coming into use to commute in London. We had horse-drawn carriages, big buggies. The royalty used to go in huge, big, this thing drawn by 6 horses and things like that. Other people would ride horses. Now, there was this one gentleman who started looking at things and he got very worried because wherever he would go on the roads, he would see horse dung. Obviously, the poor horses, they're being taken for long hours. They defecate wherever it is possible. So he started seeing this horse dung on all the roads of London. And being a mathematician or statistician, you know what he did? He started calculating. Right now we have so many horses. 10 years back we had so many. So 10 years from now we will have so many. 20 years from now we will have so many. And he started multiplying the horses, the increase in the horses with increase in horse dung. And he came out with this fantastic prediction that by the year 1920, London will have 6 feet of horse dung on all its roads. Imagine what a horrifying prediction. But did it happen? No. In 1920, lots of automobiles were happily zooming around all over the place. And of course, subsequently, they gave rise to pollution. And now we are wondering about the pollution which the vehicles are putting out. Now, that's again a new cycle that will happen. Why I'm telling you this is I want you to understand that there is this, concept of cyclical development. Life is always in cycles. Start with something simple like the weather. The weather over a period of 1 year goes into different cycles. Yet, what do? When we have summer, we do start doing whoosh, push, how hot it is. My God, Bangalore was never so hot. This city was never so hot. That place was never so hot. This year, now things are really bad. And you see how horrible the summer is. I wish when that summer will come to an end and things like that. We go on complaining. And then what happens? The monsoon comes. Big relief. Temperatures come down. Clouds, lovely weather. Rains, very soon you know what we do. So much of rain, can't step out, everywhere it is so wet, it is so slushy. So much of rain. I wish this monsoon would get over fast. That's how it goes on. Then the winter comes. Then again the summer comes. But finally what happens? The cycle keeps repeating itself. So what is this lockdown and pandemic and all that that we went through in the year 2020? It is part of a cycle. I have always been a believer that we need to adapt. Even before this pandemic, the rate at which change was taking place, starting with the change in technology, going on to the change in lifestyles. How technology initiated, promoted, and led to changes in lifestyle, changes in human relationships, changes in the way we interact, changes in the way we get up, we roam around, whatever we do. And while change is inevitable, there was this old proverb, you'll remember, that the only thing permanent in life is change, they used to say. Yes, agreed. But let us now understand that we have gone one step further. Now change is so rapid that it is not enough to adapt to change. You have to anticipate change. I've always been a believer that we must pre-plan. You can't do firefighting. You can't go to buy a fire extinguisher when the building goes on fire. You buy a fire extinguisher and keep it. It's a very small investment. And for the next 50 years, all through your lifespan, your building may never catch fire. What do you lose? You lose that little bit of money that you've invested in a fire extinguisher, right? That's all you lose. But you also have gained peace of mind. You know that you can sleep well knowing that by chance, if a fire breaks out, I have the fire extinguisher ready. I can douse the fire in minutes. But that is what we are not doing. We are not anticipating and pre-preparing for change. That is why when something like this pandemic or lockdown or something hits us, we get totally taken aback. We are becoming so complacent. As human beings, we have started thinking that we have conquered the world. Everything is now in our control. There was a time when people used to complain about weather and this and that. Now there are people who are locked up in air-conditioned rooms 12 months of the year and they don't even know what is the weather happening outside. There are people who are living in gated communities and beautiful areas and they don't even know what's happening outside their gates. When this lockdown came, most of us did not know what happened to the migrant labor, except what the media was telling us, which was quite, in many cases, exaggerated or twisted or with vested interests and all that. But in reality, were we even aware that crores and crores and crores of people could not follow the norm that we were being told, social distancing? Don't step out of your house. You don't have a house. What do you mean don't step out of the house? Social distancing. Six people crammed into one room of 10 feet by 10 feet and you say you maintain 6 feet distance from each other or something of that sort. Wash your hands 20 seconds with water. I don't even get one bucket of water to have a bath. Where do I wash my hands for 20 seconds? Use sanitizers. Sanitizers are not cheap. Not everybody can afford a sanitizer. So this is what happened. But if by chance we have been giving a blind eye to whatever happened in 2020, then we are not equipped to prepare for 2021. If you have noticed, society has got totally polarized. There are only two types of people now. One, who have been locked up in their houses for the last 9 months, refusing to step out, refusing to let their children step out. And they're waiting for this wonderful salvation. Like, you know, we talk about how great souls and angels and rescuers come from heaven to save us. And now we are looking for this great rescuer whom we call vaccine. Everything is revolving around vaccine. When the vaccine comes and when everybody is vaccinated, then only I'll step out of my house. Yeah, it's coming. So much of media, so much of news is going on, isn't it? Trials are going on. This is going on. That is going on. I will wait. Why? Because you have had the privilege of having a house, having financial resources to fall back upon. Having all the facilities where you can order whatever you want on the phone, you have electronics, you have your laptops, you can work from home. Your children are getting online classes and things of that sort. So you're sitting very complacent. But complacency has never won the day. Please remember that. As contrasted to that, there is this other segment of people who I see, and they say, yeah, the worst is over now. See, it has come down and now this is happening. Yeah, initially I was also very scared. Now, no problem. Now I'm moving around. I'm doing whatever I can. I'm very happy. I think now things are over. Vaccine is also coming, but I'm not even going to wait for the vaccine. I'm happy. I've moved out and things of that sort. Now it's just a matter of time. Schools will reopen. This will happen. That will happen. And things will get back to normalcy. Somewhere I want to caution even that segment of people. Don't be so complacent. You remember 2 days back in a city like Bangalore, we were given this shock saying that night curfew is back again. It is not just a question of night curfew. Most of us between 11 o'clock in the night and 5 o'clock in the morning may not be stepping out of the house. So physically, it did not disturb us. But did you notice the mental strain, the shock, the anxiety? Oh my God, is curfew coming back again? Now it is only in the night. Then will it increase into the day? Then will offices close down? Will I have to again lock myself up in the house? A lot of people started thinking that way. But nothing of that sort happened. So every time that there is a change, can you anticipate and can you work on it? Before we do that, let me give you a few very interesting statistics about what's happening even in the health sector. Every day without fail, many times a day, in fact, you were being given statistics. How many people afflicted with COVID? How many tested COVID positive in your locality, in your city, in your state, in your country, and globally? Numbers were being flashed left, right, and center. Then how many died out of that? Oh my, earlier it was 5 people, then 50 people, then 500 people, then 5,000 people, then 50,000 people have died. Cumulative figures have been bandied around. And we stopped talking about any other figures except this. In fact, I don't know if you have noticed, our newspapers actually used to give us the temperatures. Every day I had this habit of reading what was the maximum and minimum temperature yesterday. So I have some vague idea that, okay, it's getting colder or it's getting hotter or something. Newspapers even stopped giving that numbers. No numbers except COVID. Every number in the newspaper or wherever it is became numbered. Okay. Now let me give you a few more numbers. Compared to COVID, 2,000 people die every day due to TB. TB is also a communicable disease. We can acquire it from somebody else. 2,000 people die every day due to TB. And it is already estimated that because of the lockdown, the numbers would have gone up by at least 20% because medicine is not so long freely available. Testing is not being done. The entire process of testing for TB and this and that came down. One of my very dear friends, who's also my old student, has committed his entire life now after retirement to dealing with people with epilepsy. So they have the Epilepsy Association of India. He is very, very active in that. And in Victoria Hospital, for many years now, they've been running a free clinic. Poor people who suffer from seizures, epilepsy, they can go to Victoria Hospital, get consultation, get counseling, even at the emotional level. You know, what can I do? What should I not do? My daughter has epilepsy. Is it okay for her to marry? Can I go for a job? Can I ride a bike? All these things are being taken care of. Then the doctors, neurologists, they take interest. And finally, free medicine was given to all these poor people. For the last 8 months, Victoria Hospital has been converted into a COVID hospital. No other patient is allowed inside. So what happened to the people with epilepsy? People whose seizures were under control because they were on regular medication. Nobody even knows how badly they are suffering. No statistic. Nobody gives you anything of that sort. Before this lockdown, it was estimated that about 100 people die of snake bite every day. The number who get bitten by snakes is much more huge. Even villagers have ways and means of removing the snake poison. So majority of them do survive. But even then, at least 100 people every day were dying of snake bite. After the coming of the lockdown, we don't have any figures about that. It is estimated that in a country like India, 2.7 crore children have missed their DPT vaccination in the last 8 months. And children cannot wait. You can't give a vaccine which a baby is due this year. You can't give it next year and hope to have the same benefit. 2.3 crore children have been deprived of oral antibiotics for pneumonia, small thing like that, but very deadly. 47 lakh women have been deprived of facility-based deliveries. They had to undergo deliveries at home or whatever it is. They are also saying that this pulse polio program, which was taken up globally, which the Rotary took up so gallantly, and we almost came to the point of eradicating polio, which is, you know, again a communicable disease. We almost came to the point of eradicating polio. Already cases have started coming up. There may be 1, 2, 5 cases, doesn't matter, but that's what started with the COVID also, don't you remember? If polio comes back again, the new generation of children, how many of them are going to get disabled for life as compared to COVID, where 95%, 99% of people are resuming normal life after becoming COVID negative. And then last but not least, do not forget the crores of children who used to survive on midday meals because they used to go to their, you know, government school or municipal school or charitable school. The highlight was that they would get one nutritious meal a day, which they don't get at home. It's been more than 9 months now that children have had that nutritious meal. They are surviving on whatever their parents can give them. And parents of this segment are in a very bad situation as it is. Daily wage workers, people in small shops and small workshops, and so many other people doing some petty roadside business. So many of them have suffered in whatever way. Now, what we have done, another thing that we have done with this year is that we have tried to look for ways and means to talk about this lockdown in a positive manner. Many people, you know, my son who never used to come into the kitchen is now coming and helping me. Yes, very good. It's a novelty. He has been stuck up at home. He can't go to school. He has nothing to do. So he wanders around. He comes and says, "Mama, can I help you in the kitchen?" And then he starts cutting some vegetables or doing something, and you're so thrilled with it. My daughter, you know, little one, has learned dance, and here is a video which I am sharing with everybody else. My so-and-so, you know, the whole family now is getting together and doing this. In fact, the other day, one of my old students was telling me about how her son and his wife and children came to live with them because in the lockdown, they were living in an apartment which was totally locked in, whereas the elders were living in a little bungalow with a nice garden and open space. So they brought their children, you know, at least in the open space, in the garden, they could run around, they had a swing, they had grass, they had all these things. So they were so thrilled. So she said, "See, because of the lockdown, the whole family has come together and we are so happy." Now my question to them is, why was that son and grandchildren not with the grandchildren earlier? And do you really think that they will stick around with them once this COVID business is over? So it was only out of necessity. It was only out of convenience. Let us not celebrate these sort of things. That is what I am, you know, people say that, you know, I'm talking so negatively and this and that. No, I'm not. I'm only trying to help you to understand that let us please look deeper. Let us be flexible. Let us adapt to change. And most important, keep away from the herd mentality. So in simple words, if you ask me, what is it that we can, you know, sort of look forward to in this 2021? My simple answer is, I don't know. COVID may be eradicated, vaccine may come, and within few months, everybody will be out on the road, schools will be in full bloom and all that. That's one extreme. The other extreme is some new strain which started from UK or Mongolia or some other corner of the world will suddenly start floating all over the place, and we'll all go hurtling back into a lockdown, and the cycle will repeat itself. Between these two extremes, something is going to happen. I can't predict. I wish I was an astrologer, but I'm not. But what I am is a person who knows how to adapt. If you are, if you are willing to listen and introspect, I'm not even saying that you have to listen to me or whatever I'm saying. I'm saying you sit down and introspect. What is this thing called new normal? I totally disagree. There is nothing normal happening in the last few months. It is all new abnormal. If we surrender to this, we are being fools. We are giving up certain things which we had. Our children, whatever anybody may say about the Indian education system and all these things, our children were going to school. They were laughing, joking. They were tumbling over each other. They were handling bullying. They were going into groupism. They were coming back very depressed. They were teenagers with puppy love that my boyfriend or girlfriend has ditched me. They were having good, inspiring teachers. They had very strict teachers whom they would feel very, very angry and upset about. They would play games. They would tumble over each other. They would come back crying, saying that they are not allowing me to be part of the team. All this learning has come to a halt, and we are talking about this as new normal. Are our next generation going to grow up like that? No way. So please, with all due precautions, whatever you want to take, do not go to the extreme of locking yourself in. Start planning within the available parameters. What are you going to do? If schools do not open, we still don't know whether schools are going to open, right? Every now and then we keep hearing that, yes, they're going to open, and then they're not going to open and things of that sort. But the funny part of it is, while schools have still not opened after so many months, we had the lockdown in end of March. By May, when we started the unlock 1.0, a state like Karnataka, for example, went ahead with its 10th standard SSLC board exams. 8.5 lakh children registered for the 10th standard board exams, and 95%, 97% of them attended. How come the parents allowed them to go to a totally new place, unknown, supervisors and this and that? We don't know how many people will be there, what sort of infections will come in, but we sent them. Few days after that, the last paper of PUC, the 12th standard, was left over. 3.5 lakh children went and gave that exam. 95-97% attendance. Nobody wanted to miss out because of one exam. Nobody wanted to be deprived of the second PUC or 12th standard certification, right? Now, are we not developing double standards? Even today, when we are talking about reopening schools, we are talking about reopening only 10th and 12th standard. What's so great about the 10th and 12th standard children that only they have to learn and the others don't have to learn? No, they are facing board exams. What about the children who are facing the exams of life? How are we preparing them? In fact, how are we preparing ourselves to face the non-board exams that we have to face in life? That is what I just want you to introspect. As I told you, I don't have specific answers. I am not an astrologer. I'm not predicting what 21 is going to bring. But all the more reason that I'm exhorting you. Can you sit down and think, what happens if there is this extreme? What happens if there is that extreme? So what happens if there is something in between? Start from the macro level of what is going to happen in the country, in the state, in the city. Move slowly back to your own self, your immediate people, your family. You got elders in your house, you got children in your house. How are you going to tackle each one of these things? Work on that. What I'll do is I'll take a quick break, and I will request Seema to tell us what we in Banjara Academy are planning as far as 2021 is concerned. We are very concerned about people and we want to contribute our little mite to the society and to people around us. So we've been doing a lot of introspection as to what is it that we can do to contribute in our own humble way. What have we planned out? So she'll tell you that. But in the meanwhile, don't forget, I'll be waiting for your questions. The chat box is open. Please start putting in your questions. It'll be a pleasure to hear what your thoughts are and what you're thinking or what doubts you have. And of course, wherever possible, I'll try and give you some answers. Okay.
Hey all, so like Ali was saying, you know, we have to adapt to the current situation. And let me first quickly tell you what we did in 2020, which was very different from the earlier years. So we, of course, it was a very, very challenging time, very tough time for many of us, and especially children, the elderly. So here, counseling, you know, is free at Banjara, and counseling never stopped. So even when we were, you know, let's say March and April, when we were working with minimal staff, our counselors were continuously, you know, talking to people, counseling them, making them feel, you know, better. So that went on. Our flagship program, Diploma in Counseling Skill, which is about, you know, a lot of self-growth and development and, you know, reaching out to others by becoming a counselor. So for the last 22 years, we've always started that program in the month of June or July. And this year, we just waited. We just wanted to see how things go. And we were very surprised that many, many people are looking at self for introspect, self-growth, and people were coming and you know, enrolling for this program. Also, we saw many people changing their careers, many corporates or people from HR and other places. They wanted to now, you know, have that human element, the human touch, which our Diploma in Counseling Skills program provides. So we started off, but this time the change was that we didn't start all together, all the four teams, but we staggered it. So we started two in August, one in September, and one in October. And now we have full-fledged teams, and it's such a wonderful a thing, you know, the whole place is buzzing with the activity. There is Christmas celebration, there are birthday celebrations. So it's so nice to have, you know, people come over to our center, whether for their personal counseling or whether for learning how to become a counselor. So Banjara has been bustling with a lot of activities, and that's how we like it, you know, that personal touch and warmth. Another thing we did was the Manthan camp in October and December. We have a small retreat near North Bangalore, DPS North. So there we did, the first one was on, you know, inner happiness. So, you know, we spent the whole day introspecting, and, you know, we came out with a lot of, I mean, everybody did their own introspection, and same for the December camp, which was on how to love yourself. Again, these two experiences were wonderful for all the participants, our students and our alumni and other friends. It was open to all. One change we did this year was that for two of our programs, you know, that is CCAD, Child and Adolescent Development, and the PGDP program, which is Psychotherapies, we went online for the first time because we felt that definitely our counseling program cannot be, you know, done online. But these two programs could be, because it is a lot of self-introspection, a lot of work on yourself, a lot of thinking. So we thought, let's you know, do it this time. And the better, I mean, the positive thing that came out of it was many people from outside Bangalore could join us for these programs. So we have full-fledged classes of, you know, 40 to 50 students in both these programs, and they're really loving the two programs. So that's about this year, 2020. We planned a wonderful year ahead, you know, again, keeping in mind a lot of introspection, the fact that people want to upskill themselves, and people want to probably take up a career in, you know, either working with children or in life skills. So we've come up with a lot of things. One very interesting program we are coming up in January, a webinar, that will be a webinar, a paid webinar on preparing for marriage. So, you know, that will be on 9th of January. So that's something I can, we can give you the details. So please reach out. You know, that's for, what are those, you know, things that are important before you actually get into a relationship with another person. So that is what Dr. Ali will be covering for us. And one more thought which came to our mind again, and we are working on that is, you know, the life skills program. So we are planning and working on a nice 6 months life skills program for a lot of self growth and development, as well as to become a life skills trainer. So we're looking at starting early next year. So, you know, you can check out our website. We'll be putting all our programs there. And of course, the enrollments for our DCS program for 2022 have opened up, and many people are coming, inquiring. So all those people who were a little hesitant to come out this year, they are all looking forward to joining us for our Diploma in Counseling Skills program. So many, many other programs we have in mind. So please reach out to us. You know, you can see our website, and we'll keep putting, you know, whatever is coming. So we are really looking forward to 2021. So all the best to all of you.
Yes, I'm back, but my chat box is empty. How sad. I thought I have stimulated your mind a little bit. As I said, you don't have to agree with me. You can come out with totally different viewpoint. More the merrier, the more, the different views and this and that. It always stimulates. Whatever board will decide is not in parents' hand, but how to prepare child to adopt new changes in college and hostel. Yes. Depending on what your child, this is at an individual level. Let's say, you know, you are planning to send your child to hostel. Again, we don't even know when hostels will open, whether your child will go there or not. Okay, let us presume that the hostels are opening out in a particular university or college, and you're going to send your child over there. Prepare him or her for basic life skills. That's what, you know, last night itself, we had a very detailed discussion among our team. What Seema was sharing with you, that let us keep imparting life skills. Now, we can't reach out to children, definitely, because our children are not available to us. We have our Gurukul, where we would love to have dozens and dozens of children whom we can teach life skills very well. But if they're not available, people will not send them. We will not be able to do it. So we are at least trying to train people like you to go ahead and you know, train your children or whatever other children in these basic life skills, how to handle different types of situations. What happens if there is a financial crisis? What happens if there's a health crisis? What happens if somebody whom you know or somebody whom you love acquires some illness, be it COVID, be it any other major illness or whatever it is? What happens if there is a death taking place? Nobody prepares anyone for death. These are all part of life skills. This is what I want us to please focus on in this year 2021. Let us enjoy it. I plan to have all the tiny tots get into small group and plan interesting activities, both indoor and outdoor, on Children's Day. Gave it a try with few like-minded. Went off very well. Hearty congratulations, Prema. I wish your tribe increases. I have been getting a few of our old students who have been doing something very similar. And each one of them, I am congratulating, I am lauding, and I am really, you know, appreciative of these people. Even if you have two children who are coming to you or 20 children who are coming to you, if you can work with them, nothing like it. Please do not deprive the children. Are the courses you will be offering online? We have both. Where it is possible to give online, we are giving it online. But where we are clear that no, we need the human touch. We are not succumbing to the temptation that just by doing it online, we'll get more registrations or we'll get more fees or something. No, we are not into that thing. So those which have to be face-to-face, we insist on doing it face-to-face. We are already very successfully running the CCAD, that is the Certificate in Child and Adolescent Development, which is an online course. But you know what we have done in that? We are giving an option to people to have the mentoring groups, small groups of 5, 6, 7 people with one mentor once a week. Those who can't come or who are out of town, they are on having online sessions. Those who are willing to come, they come here. They thoroughly enjoy that 1 or 2 hours that they spend with the mentor, small group. Somebody brings some eat, somebody has some joke, somebody has something to share about their children. It is so much more meaningful. Many students are not having the privilege of online classes, particularly in rural areas, and that may turn out to dropouts. This is a very, very important point. I'm glad Dr. Dharnish has brought out, because he's a professor of community medicine himself, our old student. I really have appreciated people like Dharnish who have, you know, gone out of the way to reach out to those of the underprivileged people. And that is what I'm talking about. The schemes like the Vidyagama, which the government had started off, just get a few people in some courtyard of a temple or community center, make them sit under the tree with 5 feet distance from each other. And whichever teacher, whoever is willing to come, let them teach. It is not that you have to teach them science and social studies and language and mathematics. Anything that can be taught, even sitting and telling stories to the children, asking the children to talk about their lives, even that is education. But that has to be done face to face. I really wish the government would give more and more permission for these sort of things to happen. We are doing that as our unschooling program. We are inviting children, small numbers, 2, 3, 4 children come, sit very comfortably, all these things. And they learn so much. I'm not bragging because my team is doing it. But these children are learning so much, I assure you. It's so sad that we all concentrate on just the cognitive aspects of kids, school, exam, no talk about their socio-emotional growth. No, we are talking, Smita, there is a small awareness which is growing, but let us keep pushing. Today's whole focus of today's interaction with you all is just to help you understand, let us focus on life skills. Life is there, no, we are not dead. Till the last day, till we die, life is going to be there. We all people in general have to be self-responsible for their health, following some discipline in everything like celebration or shopping, outing on our own is better rather than complaining. Absolutely right, Jaya. There's no question of complaining about government, deals, that we have to take life in our own hands. We have to decide what is to be done within our own circles, but with a little more courage than what we have been showing. We should not, you know, be so scared. Always being ready for new aspects of life is important, and it affects a lot of mental health. Absolutely. People who can, you know, face stress with least distress, as they say, those are the people who are going to be happy and successful in life. Offline sessions are much more meaningful because of the personal human touch, Ramit says. I agree with you. Absolutely agree with you. Let us not forget the human touch, whatever may happen. Without that, there's no point in just dragging on life, just surviving locked up in our houses and this and that for months and years. That's not what life is meant to be. Amit says, what you said, we don't prepare children for death. I've seen within my extended family, it's treated as a taboo to speak about death to kids. Yes, that I think is a great blunder that we are doing. If we cannot teach a child to understand death, we cannot teach a child to understand life. We must start with these small things. And you don't have to wait till a death actually takes place. Why not sit and have a chat with your own children, or, you know, a group of children about what is life and what is death? I wish parents and teachers can have the courage to suspend bookish lessons and even help kids and their parents to enhance their life skills and change management and change response strategies. Yes, Smita, I agree, but then forget about the other parents and teachers. Let us take the lead. I told you, we have barely 2, 3, 4 children in our group who are doing this unschool thing. They come and spend 2, 3 hours, thoroughly enjoy themselves. They've been doing it for months now, from the time the lockdown was lifted and the restrictions were lifting. Yes. And it is a learning for us. It is a stress buster to us. Those of us who are spending time with these children, we realize that, you know, we are entering into a new world, sitting with half a dozen children, laughing, joking with them, exploring the world, exploring different types of thinking and this and that. It takes away our negativity and our stress and strain about the life that we are facing. Vinita says, I too feel the longer we take the break, it will be a lot more time for children to get back to track. Very true. And it's all in our mind how we are seeing or rather taking this phase particularly. The more we accept as a normal course, of course, with precautions, it will be easier to face and strong message to our younger generation. That's why, although it may have sounded morbid to you, why I read out all those statistics about TB and snake bites and these and that, and I can go on endlessly with those type of things. Take even HIV AIDS, 3.5 million people have died of HIV and AIDS. We're not talking about that at all. It is still rampant. HIV AIDS has not been brought under control. People are still suffering from it. But nobody gives us those statistics. No, nobody talks about this. The way people's mental health is getting affected. People who have thalassemia and who need blood transfusions. Most of the blood banks are not getting blood now because everybody is so scared. A simple thing like going and donating blood, which all of us used to do so happily. We used to organize blood camps here in Banjara itself, and people used to come and voluntary day donate blood and things of that. So all that has been wiped out. Don't we care for these people, or do we wait till it happens only to us? Only when I need the blood, then I'm going to make a hue and cry about it. We cannot be so selfish. Dhanish also says that if there could be a year dedicated to reaching out to others, wonderful, Dhanish. 2021 should be that year. All of us should take this commitment to reach out to maximum number. Yes, forget about maximum number also, Dhanish and others. 1, 2, 3, let's start with that. You know that, very famous quote of Mother Teresa when people said that, you know, how many people will you help? How many places you will go? How many cities and countries will you go? How many poor people will you take care of? She said, I know what I am doing is a drop in the ocean, but the ocean would have been poorer without that drop. Every drop counts. Let us not look at numbers. That's been our policy. That's what we teach our counselors also. Shobha says, my students' parents have so many problems like social, mental, emotional, family, and alcoholic addiction problems. How can I help them? Please help them just by providing emotional support. That's it. Be there. Listen to them. Encourage them to talk about what they are feeling. Most people are getting scared to say so. As I told you, no, they're trying to pretend, yeah, everything is going fine. We are very nice. Our family has bonded so well. Our children are enjoying online classes. I think we are being hypocrites. I think somewhere along the line, we are trying to fool ourselves. Forget about fooling anybody else. So gently nudge them, Shobha. Tell them, I'm there. Let's talk about it. What are the issues that you're facing? Do you have any anxieties? Do you have any fears? Once the anxieties and fears come out, no, then people feel a little more encouraged, a little more courageous. When they know that there are other people with me to help out, I'm not alone. What if COVID prolongs in 2021? How long will we deprive our children of their childhood? What if COVID prolongs or comes in a new form in 2022? 2023, 2026, it will come. We had dengue, we had H1N1, we had swine flu, we had so many things. We never panicked the way we are panicking over here. Yes, we did have a spurt of a few days, few weeks when the number of cases, number of deaths shot up, but even then they shot up to what levels? Negligible compared to the population of the cities and countries. We're talking about India being the second country in the world to reach some 1 million, 10 million, something of that sort. You're forgetting about India's population. We are 130 plus crore of people. So if 1 lakh people die, 10 lakh people die, that is nothing compared to what is happening. More people die of traffic accidents day in and day out. More people die out of so many other things. More people die out of suicide when we talk about mental health. We have stopped even checking out. And believe me, there's going to be a pandemic of depression and suicide once these things lift up. That has always been the case, that when a trauma takes place, you know, after the trauma is lifted, let's say we get the vaccine and this and that, whatever it is, and it goes away. After that, the effect is going to be very bad. Shruti says, Banjara Academy is indeed giving great opportunities to human beings around the globe to change and help themselves and help everyone. that has been our little humble mission or our contribution, Shruti, and I, we want to continue. And as I was telling earlier, each one of us can. You don't need an academy or an institution or a platform to do it. You see an elderly person in your vicinity, reach out. You see a child, reach out. You see your own relative, reach out. Kanaka is asking how much of 2020 lockdown would have impact on people to adopt in 2021. Great impact. That's what I was telling you. You must have all heard of this thing called PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. Trauma. What was this trauma? The lockdown, pandemic, fear of death, fear of infection, all that. Post-traumatic. That means after the trauma is over, a lot of people suffer from what is known as a stress disorder. So PTSD is post-traumatic stress disorder. Every time it hits, there's a lot of data available on what happened after Second World War got over. Things were very bad. The Allies were thinking that Germany will overtake them and England and so many countries will just get wiped out and things of that sort. Went through a very horrifying phase, right? But they won the war. Even in India, if you see, we were subservient to the British. If Great Britain had lost the war and Hitler had taken over, today we would have been giving the Nazi salute and saying, Heil Hitler or something of that sort. We would have become German citizens, but nothing of that sort happened. We did move on. But at the emotional, mental level, millions of people, including very courageous military people and all that, they went through post-traumatic stress disorder. In fact, psychology took very great strides just after the Second World War because of people who got interested in helping all these people, the great heroes, the people who went to war, the wives and families who were left behind and who had to fend for themselves, not for months, but for years, how they survived without their breadwinner and without their man of the house at home and things of that sort. All these examples we have, methodologies are available. We just have to, number one, understand the significance of it. Let us actually look forward to 2021 as a year after having learned this lesson. Chalini says, how difficult is it going to be going back to normal life and following the earlier schedule post-COVID? What can one work on so that transition back is going to be smooth? Transition back is not going to be smooth, Chalini. Let me also caution you. Let me not paint a very rosy picture. It is going to be rough. But that does not mean just because when I am traveling on a road and I know I have to go to my destination, just because the road is bad and it has got potholes or traffic jams, I don't stop, right? I just see what is the best way of traversing this distance and reaching my goal. So each one of us, I'm repeating it again, start right now with working with whatever is available. Do not wait for vaccines and schools reopening and this and that. That is not in our control. But developing ourselves, developing our relationships, giving a level playing platform to our children, giving reassurance, love, affection to our elders, that is in our hands. I know of people who stopped hugging each other within their own family because they're scared of COVID. What COVID is going to happen if you hug your child or your old grandmother or something of that sort? We are taking it to ridiculous extents. Please break through from that thinking. It is very important. Start with these little steps. Tell yourself that in the next 1 week, when the new year starts, I'm going to list down, make a small list, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to reach out to my family members or extended family or neighbors. I'm going to develop my own inner strength or that courage or optimism. I am not going to become, dependent on this so-called vaccine and this and that. Otherwise what will happen? One vaccine will come. Millions of people will get vaccinated, and just when we are thinking that things are okay, you will hear of 10 people who died because of the vaccine. Finished. We'll go all the way back to square one, and again the whole process will start all over again. But as I said, that is a cycle. It is cyclical. It will happen. But today we are alive, no? Not only are we alive, if you look at it, this COVID thing rationally, we are also healthy and fit. 90% of the people whom I came across who became COVID positive were not bedridden or, you know, suffering from excruciating pain or something. Okay, they may have had pain even for 1, 2, 3 days, but they bounce back in no time. Compare that to people with so many other ailments and diseases where they are suffering for days and months and years, lifelong, some of them. They are also living, isn't it? I know people who have survived the most horrifying ailments, people who have lost their limbs, people who have gone through the worst of trauma, people who, you know, have been through major mental illness and now have recovered to whatever extent. They are all living in this world. They are carving out their future. They are charting out their path of life. They are building their relationships. Why should one single COVID undo everything that we have stood for as human beings? As compassionate, caring people, we have always reached out to others. And more so, I'm very proud to say that in our culture, we as Indians have always taken that extra step to be nice to people. We have always had compassion. We have always thought about the deprived people. This time, somewhere, I think we have slipped out. We didn't even realize how many crores of people, migrant laborers, petty hawkers, daily wage earners, how they suffered because of things and how they are still suffering because of that. I came across a very sad case of a young couple and their two tiny children. All four of them committed suicide because they were being thrown out by their landlord. They were living in a tiny place. For months, they could not pay the rent. The landlord had given them an ultimatum saying that by first of the month, if you don't pay, I'm going to throw you out. This man already had lost his job. He had no other source of income and things. He had relatives. The relatives were so distraught. They were crying so miserably saying, if only he had told us, we would have paid that rent money or whatever is required. But he had his self-worth, his dignity. He said, no, I'm not going with a begging bowl. I've always, you know, looked after myself and my family. Now I can't go with a begging bowl to my relatives or friends or whatever it is. And he discussed with his wife and both of them killed their children. And now this doesn't come out in the vast media, no? Because they didn't die of COVID. They only died of suicide, idiots. That is how we look at them. Please do not. Let's widen our thinking, our way of approach to life. Let's come together. Let's use this as a means to, you know, reinforce ourselves, become better as human beings. I do not think human beings are greater than any other beings. I think there are so many animals, birds, insects, which are far superior to us in terms of team spirit, in terms of emotional intelligence, in terms of how they take care of each other. Let us also rise to that occasion. We can do it. So thanks to all of you who came out with your comments or your questions. It helps us to stimulate our mind and think, you know, even when you ask a question or when you come out with your comments, I always look forward to that. That's one good thing about these programs, that even though we are far away from each other, we are not sitting in the same premises or something, I still get to interact. And that's one of the reasons why we are continuing with this. Every week we are having these programs. So what is on the next Saturday, Seema?
Emotional honesty.
Emotional honesty. Next Saturday, we are going to be discussing emotional honesty. If you have a doubt, what is this thing called emotional honesty? I know emotion, I know honesty, but what is emotional honesty? Don't ask me now. Ask me next Saturday when we meet. But before that, before we sign off, let me quote to you something that was written 100 years back. Guruji Rabindranath Tagore, amazing man he was. His thinking was unbelievable. He said, and I'm sure you heard this before, but I'll take the trouble of again reminding you. Rabindranath Tagore said, where the mind is without fear, fear of COVID, okay? Where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, not bound by online classes. Where the world is not broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls, locking up ourselves in our 2 BHK, 3 BHKs. Their words come from the depth of truth. Their tireless striving stretches its arm towards perfection. Where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habit, rumors, negative social, gossip and things like that. Where the mind is led forward by thee into even widening thought and action, into that heaven of freedom, my Father, let my country awake. Let the entire humanity awake into that heaven of freedom. It is there right around the corner, waiting for us to take that one step forward. Let's all do that. In anticipation and in advance, wishing all of you a very, very happy new year and a very promising new year. See you next Saturday. Bye-bye. Thank you.